Hello and welcome back to the Circuito de Jerez and Hell Nieto. It's the final day of the 2021 year, the second day of the Jerez test and second day of the 2022 season. And there has been a plenty going on down in pit lane. Lots of new parts, lots of different stuff we've seen. So we may as well crack onto it. My name's Jack Gorse, Simon Crayfair alongside me as always. We'll just dive right into it, Simon. First off, well, we'll kick a quick rundown of the manufacturers. Aprilia, let's start off with them.
Yes, brilliant. What I've seen today and yesterday afternoon, they're trying different wings on the front. And as we mentioned yesterday, each rider has a different bike. It's a slightly upgraded chassis and engine and exhaust. So Aprilia are trying hard.
Yeah, they certainly are. They've got quite a few bits, as Simon says, and it seems to be that both riders are fairly happy with certain new stuff that they've tried. Moving on then, Ducati has been a big one. We've obviously seen a huge new aero package and air intake, but there's been plenty of other stuff as well, namely that massive exhaust.
Yeah, so we saw a crazy exhaust. I mean, it's got to be a foot and a half longer than standard from the front cylinders yesterday. I guess GG's trying to figure out what that does exactly, a little test. We also saw a quite different fairing with aero on it and intake. So with the air intake for the engine in the center, it's quite different. And the kind of wings on the side a bit different. And it looks like they've stayed with it. I saw Jorge Martin, Jack Miller and Bagnaia out with it, and they've all stayed on that today. So
yeah, they certainly seem quite happy with it. If you're watching on the time screens at home, I'm sure you'll know this already, but Pekka Bagnaia at the moment is top of the times by 0.8 seconds, so certainly not too bad.
And
indeed,
in this wind, to be as fast as he is, you're only talking tenths, you know, less than a second off the outright lap record around here in this wind.
Yeah,
that's scary fast.
We'll come on to the wind again later, because today it's just as big a problem as yesterday. But first, Honda, another new chassis that we've seen. We think that Bradl tested it 2 days ago before our cameras arrived, but now we've seen it this morning with Taka Nakagami, and it seems positive.
Yes, yesterday when I saw Taka was fastest, I know Neil Morrison mentioned the same, and that Taka, with no pressure on him, goes well, you know. And Jerez, he goes well, he always goes well here. He was straight on the pace, so it was hard to read where, how good the bike is, you know. And then, but then I thought about it, he's also on the older one and he went faster on the new one. I kind of tried to find out from the test team what they thought of it. They wouldn't say anything, but there were smiles and confidence there, like they'd done a good job, you know. And so from the outside, I actually said this to Alberto, because Alberto, from the outside, the new bike looks good. And he basically said, Simon, from the outside, what you see is not reality. I love Alberto. He's such a straight shooter. But I feel they have made some progress. That's what it looks like to us, doesn't it?
Yeah, it really does. It looks like they made quite a big step forward. Paul Espargaró also has the 2022 bike this morning and is going to continue to try it this afternoon. And he seems
it looks
to be
like
happy
there's
too.
Two, doesn't there?
Yes.
Two slightly different ones. He's
two
been riding
different.
One all morning.
Yeah.
Tucker's got the other. And apparently this afternoon he's going to do some more. I bet they swap.
Yeah. Well, as we say, there's two different chassis on the 2022 bike, and one of them, we believe, is an evolution of something we saw here 6 months ago. So if you want to know more about that, head over to the MotoGP Tech Facebook group. There's some pictures in there for you as well. Now, moving on, KTM, also new aero, and it's a slight tweak from the one we saw yesterday, but largely the same.
Yeah, different aero intake as well, something we haven't really seen before. Looks like two tubes, you know, it's got an outer ring that's free. It must be something to do with the aero as it enters, you know. I'm not sure. I had a good close look, and the inner tube just goes in sort of this far, and then it's all in one into the airbox. Anyway, different side scoop type thing, wings on the side. The bikes that I'm looking at in the factory team have still the sticker from Valencia Race on them, so to me it's still their base bike. There was one other there, and then there's the test team, Callio and also Pedrosa, and curiously they're on different chassis than the Tech 3 guys and Binder
and Miguel
Oliveira. has had one of each, which makes sense to me because he's been injured in sort of the time that it was important to try both. So I think he's revisiting it. This wind is picking up even more. It's a bit of a haze come in this last 2 minutes. And visibility's going down. It looks like sand or something blowing around. Yeah. It's horrendous and windy.
It seems a bit then as the clock is ticking on the time that they're going to have left here. It's also ticking on us, so let's crack on. Suzuki. It's kind of a strange one with Suzuki. We know they're testing loads and loads of stuff, but it's so hard to spot. We've seen a few small aero tweaks, some different side fairings, maybe changing the exhaust vents out the back of the radiator.
Swing arm, aero, like you said, and engine. Yeah. I got told last night they've settled on an engine for next year. They've kind of confirmed it. So, but the scary thing to me is it is not miles faster. Not that you can tell in Jerez. I think that's what Yamaha also told me. At Jerez, the straight's so short, how do you tell if you've improved top ends, you know? Because there's no top end really here. But the scary thing is the V4s are so fast now, the inlines, meaning the Suzuki and the Yamaha, really need to make a step. Yeah. And the new engine on Suzuki doesn't look to me that it's that massive step. So it's lots of little things. Hopefully they add up to enough. Oh, the other thing about Suzuki, I saw two different ride height devices on the bike. They've been playing with those for a while because I think it's so important. That's going to make a bigger difference again.
And then coming on to the last manufacturer, Yamaha. Yamaha, well, they're certainly working their socks off at the moment. We've seen a radical new chassis. It's not massively different, but it has some welds that we've not seen before at all. Yamaha chassis is quite a change.
Yeah, they've got two versions of chassis, haven't they, that you spotted yesterday. It's got a good eye. And today we saw another one again. It's kind of an experiment chassis by the looks. Yeah. It looks like the 21 chassis,
yeah.
Sorry, 22 chassis with extra welded on bits. I was really curious. So I watched Fabio when he came back in for the debrief. And from what I saw, he couldn't tell the difference. You know, he wasn't going, hey, that. He was like, feels the same. That's the impression I got. Yamaha, I think, in the same boat as Suzuki. They need to make a step with that engine because everything else is pretty close. And if those guys don't make a step with the engine, they're going to have to keep pushing that front tire and keep having problems like they've had recently.
Well, to find out if Yamaha have made a step, obviously you need to listen to After the Flag tonight at 5:30. But now we're on the topic of Yamaha, we can actually drag in Razlan Razali, the team boss and owner of the brand new WithU Yamaha RNF MotoGP team. If we can just drag Razlan in, we'll come and ask him some questions. He's obviously got a very exciting year. Hi, Razlan, how are you?
Doing?
You just stand in the middle for me, please.
How are you doing?
Good, how are you?
Good. Oh, busy.
Obviously, yeah, well, that's the thing. A busy day for you. Two brand new riders and also a brand new team. How's it going?
Well, first of all, it's unusual to come up to the test with this attire. I think a lot of people couldn't recognize me without the previous livery. So, yeah, it's been a busy couple of months. Basically, we're building a new MotoGP team in less than 3 years, you know. So, something that I don't want to do it again, but you have to do it. So, here we are. As a new team.
Well, it's certainly quite a busy day, and I know that Simon's got some questions about how your riders are getting on.
Yeah, Razlan, the first thing I wanted to get across to the listeners from you is, you on one side of the garage you've got Darren Binder. You've done this before, taken a risk with a young guy, and it worked with Fabio. You were the one that, and now you've done it with Darren. You've obviously worked with him for a few years, seen something in him. So I'd love to hear about that and the crew chief. Before we get to talk about, you've also got the most experienced guy in the paddock on the other side of the garage. I guess he's helping with testing.
Yeah, we like to do something different. You know, from day one, we try to do it differently. With Fabio, it was a risk in 2019, but we are taking a greater risk with Darren because he's from Moto 3. But when you look at his size, his weight, and the disadvantage that he has in Moto 3. And the way for him to make up places, to break hard, you know, to attack, we thought there's something in him that we felt we need to give him a chance and try him out. Being an underdog, this is what we like, is that you can be full of surprises, but at the same time, it can be bad for us. But that's being an underdog all about, you know.
I love it. I love that you've taken a risk. I love the rookies coming through. So brilliant. One more thing on Darren. You've got a really experienced crew chief working with him.
Yeah, that's another big surprise that came to us. So we have Noe, who is the crew chief for Raul Fernandez in Moto2, with close to 19 years of experience with a lot of riders, with Raul, with Miguel, with Brad Binder, with Zarco. So there's something in him that he's able to develop riders to become great riders. So we hope that together with Noe and Darren, he can do something for Darren and help him out for next year.
Brilliant. On the other side of the garage, Dovi, the most experienced guy in the whole paddock.
Yes.
And I, from what I've seen, Yamaha are using him testing-wise as well. Is that correct?
Yeah. My experience with Andrea is that he's very analytic, okay, very clear in what he wants, the problem with the bikes. Hence, Yamaha pay a lot of emphasis to his comments and feedback, which is great. You know, so I think they need a different perspective from a different rider, especially an experienced one. And he will contribute to the whole development and also to help Darren at the same time.
Sorry, I hogged it all there, Jack. Back to you.
No problem. And finally, Razan, just one more question. Really, we've seen Darren slowly progress over the next day and a half, and also Dovi looking as though he's getting more comfortable as well. Going forward to the 22 season, are there any expectations for either rider?
Well, I think beginning with Andre, he has a lot to prove. To come back, to do 5-6 races this year, to get on the same bike. I think next year he will want to go for it. You know, I don't see the point of him coming back and not try. So with a balance of experience and youth, I think we expect Andrea to do well and to fight for the championship. With Darren, obviously there's 5 rookies, and the target is for him to be the best rookies. I think that's the best that we can expect and target for him, and that's it.